It was not unusual to deal with as many as 80 students a year. One year, a recruiter from Stanford came to speak on campus. He told the students, "At Stanford, we don't care what subject interests you. We simply want you to be the best at whatever you do." I honestly have not heard of another college in America with a calligraphy tradition better than ours. Calligraphy is a worthy part of Reed's 100 years of achievement in human education. The students are the reason we have colleges, and the students have shown their appreciation for this class that taught them that important words should be written with respect and honor. The class was never simply concerned with teaching everyone to write italic with a chisel-edged pen. The majority of students taking the class were not art majors seeking to add one more art form to their resumes. They came from many different sections of the college, as I realized from all the thesis orals that I was asked to attend. Calligraphy at Reed was always optional. It was never required of anyone. When I studied under Father Cadditch at St. Ambrose College in Davenport, every art major was required to take the calligraphy class. Father Cadditch had founded the art department at St. Ambrose, and he was a world-famous calligrapher. He was a versatile scholar of many disciplines. In addition to calligraphy, he taught a wide variety of art classes. He taught music, math, and engineering. He had played in a symphony orchestra and had a degree in theology from the Gregorian University in Rome. He had also worked as a professional letter artist in Chicago. He and Lloyd Reynolds were longtime friends, and both were leaders in restoring calligraphy in America. It was through Lloyd that I met Cadditch and was able to study with him as a private student. As an institution of higher learning, Reed has always been committed to excellence. I think the success of the teaching and practice of calligraphy on the West Coast was in large measure due to its reputation as an important class at Reed. A Reed professor giving handwriting instruction on a PBS program continued to give prestige to this growing art. It did indeed grow. Before Lloyd began teaching calligraphy here, it was either ignored by other colleges or simply taught as commercial lettering. As I mentioned 8 years ago, Professor Norman Pache of Lewis and Clark College told me he could hardly get enough students for his lettering class before Lloyd started the calligraphy class here. In a short time, he had the opposite problem. His calligraphy class had too many students for the size of the room. Calligraphy, as Grayley Hewitt said many years ago, is everyone's art. Art should be a vital part of civilization. It should make people more human. Unfortunately, some of the art we see in shows today seems to be opposed to rather than constructive of human qualities. The 20th century composer-educator William Schumann has written, "The arts are crucial to our automated age. They serve as a creative illumination to counteract the push-button emptiness of our mechanized life, an armor against the disillusionment and anxiety of our times, and an added defense against the destructive forces inherent in man. For educators not to grasp the vitality, the spirituality and the intellectuality of art as central to an educated person is to ignore the measure by which our civilization will be judged. The quote I have chosen to write today is important to me, especially because of the direction that some artists tend to travel in our modern world. Giuseppe Verdi was one of the greatest opera composers of all time. Speaking of his compositions, he said, "La parola regna suprema." The words are the most important. This should be remembered by all who write letter forms. The calligrapher can be instrumental in bringing important truths and inspiring thoughts to the attention of many who might not otherwise listen to them. This was an important aspect of writing for Lloyd. He could see decorative art painting dominating the presentation of texts and overshadowing them. He objected to this with vigor, and you all remember Lloyd's vigor. The famous definition of art by Thomas Aquinas was something Lloyd repeated often, recta ratio factibilium, the right way of making things, or making things according to right reason. The artist who writes should present the words without interfering with them. The text should inspire the calligrapher who should write it to inspire others. I saved a note Lloyd wrote many years ago, which I think seems to sum up his idea of calligraphy. Calligraphy is a striving toward pure spirit through total design, involving a rhythm expressive of both the meaning of the passage and the feeling of the calligrapher regarding the passage, but according to the meaning of the passage, not self-expression. Calligraphy was a great tradition here at Reed. I am honored to have been a part of it. Now, as I say, the quote I chose to write today is from Giuseppe Verdi, and once again, I will call upon my good friend Ludwig van Beethoven to accompany me while I am writing. Writing with music is not something you do like dancing. When you dance to the music. When you write with the music. It inspires me as I hear the music and helps me to write. I never try to keep with the music. And since I am beginning with a brush, I will begin with the second movement of the fifth piano concerto, which I used last time. It just seems to go really well with calligraphy. When I used to attend the symphony concerts, I remember sitting there, and many times this was at the end of the day after working all day, so I was quite tired and sleepy. And the music was wonderful, but I imagined how wonderful it would be to have a screen overhead and have some beautiful scenery to go with the music. And that's the way I feel with calligraphy and music. They seem to go together. And so now I shall move over to my other area.